I'll give you a boxing story. Because I haven't done one in a while. And I don't like to use names because you really don't know how other people feel about stuff like that, you know. You'll tell a story and somebody be, man, I didn't want them to know that about me. You could have said that about so-and-so. You know, I've seen that happen. So that's why sometimes I don't like tell stories or like to use people's names and put them out there in such a public fashion without, you know, being okay with it. But situation happens where these two brothers, they were boxers. They're from Waukegan, Illinois. If anybody knows where that is, they're in Waukegan, Illinois. You got Anthony and you got Jose. Both of them were like top boxing, like winning awards. Now, Jose is the big brother. Anthony's the little one. Now, Jose, he's about 4 years older than Anthony. You know, but Anthony hangs out with him all the time. Like, all Jose friends is Anthony friends. You know, then things started changing. You know, once Jose graduated from high school and stuff, you know, they were still going to the gym and boxing and training with the coach. But things started to change once his brother, you know, they still lived in the same crib with their parents. But once he left and started doing his, left the high school and his brother was coming into high school, this is when things started to change. Because now his brother was known through the school, you know, and now he's feeling he the man now. Like, people like, hey, man, what's up with him, your little brother, you know, Anthony. So Anthony's feeling himself, you know, like, yeah, you know, I'm the man as a freshman coming through there. He running the school. So he decides that he gonna throw parties at the house, you know, and do his own thing. And now his brother is really boxing. He's trying to go for Golden Gloves. He's traveling for the tournament. His brother's not boxing really too much anymore now. He's noticing that. So he's like, man, you know, like, what's going on with you? He was, oh, man, you know, I'm just thinking I'm finna go into, like, this, they had a baseball team. He's like, man, I'm gonna go try out for the baseball team. I might try that, man, instead of boxing, you know. I might still do the boxing, but I want to go into baseball. So his brother was like, oh, okay, all right. I just didn't want to know why you weren't coming to the gym like you used to. So all of this is going on. And I'm going to speed this up. But he runs into a guy that's called Shorty E. Lil Edgar, basically. And Lil Edgar was a four-corner hustler. And probably still is. Lil Edgar has made his life being shiesty. Being the fact that I knew Lil Edgar, you know, through the walks of life, the fact that he's way too old to be hanging out with Anthony was an understatement. But Anthony was impressed by how he was able to command people, because he had what they call a UE. And he will always tell you he got four of them. I got four UEs. And a UE is a universal elite four corner hustle. And he said he got four. I got four UEs. And he'll let you know off the bat that he's just not some regular guy. He was also an enforcer. So Ant started hanging out with some of his guys, Lil E guys, and he decides he's going to get put on. And, you know, they was like, man, we're going to put this little dude on, because he's seeing guys over here with Lexus. They rolling up in the 300s. And he's like, man, I got to have that. So everybody wanted the Lex Ball and Altimas and brand new cars. So he was all impressed with that. and that lifestyle. So Anthony started hanging out with them, started selling packs, started doing all this craziness. And his brother Jose is like, man, seeing his brother come in at 2 in the morning, his parents is calling, like, he's not going to school really like he's supposed to. He's sleeping in class when he is there. And his teachers say he's now failing. So Jose is pissed. So he goes up there and whoops his brother's ass at the school and embarrassed him. So Jose's thinking, like, man, maybe I'm going to beat some sense into my brother. So he whoops his brother's ass at the school and tell him to get his ass home. And after that, the brother really went to school and said, you know what, forget this. You know, I'm through with my brother. I don't got nothing to do. I'm going to school. I'm going to stay at my boy crib. So he went and did that. But at the same time, he forgot he left some packages at the house. His brother found it and said, you a dope head or you selling dope. But anyway, this is going down the toilet. I just thought I'd let you know. So he flushed his work down the toilet. So when the Four Corner Hustlers caught up to his little brother, Anthony, they was choking him and beating the hell out of him. And he came home from school. He went back home. He didn't go to his boy's crib. And his brother saw him all beat up. And Jose was like, man, you who did this to you? He was like, you did. When you flushed that work down the toilet, you did this to me. When you threw them drawers out, you did this to me. Now they gonna kill me. So now you just killed me. And, man, next day, he went to school. He saw the dudes. Jose drove him to school. Got out. Gave him the boxing lesson of a lifetime. Beat 3 guys in a boxing match. Basically. Whooped 3 dudes. After he whooped the 3 dudes, man, the whole school was just basically like, man, woo, Jose, man, he still got it. Next day, he drive him back up to school. Then nobody want Anthony. They went right after Jose. And he was like, y'all back to get y'all ass whooped again? And the dude pulled out a gun and shot him. Jose's dead. Now, you would think that this tragedy to this brother, your older brother who came there to fight for you, now dead, you would think in this tragedy, this would turn Anthony around. This is a movie. This is what would happen. He would see that happen and turn his life around and this and that. But no, he's going at it harder now. Now his brother's out the way and ain't even thinking about boxing. And he's hustling. He in the street. He got tats. He's got gold chains. He's wilding out. He's got guns. And he get introduced. Now he goes from Waukegan, he goes further out west. He's out there by like Humble Park. Like he's over there in Austin where the Four Corner Hustler Network is. And I knew another guy that they were dealing with. Man, I tell you, I could have been the drug kingpin of the city of Chicago just by happenstance. I happened to meet people. And their rank and association just happened to be like the most notorious people in the world. But I knew them before they were all the notorious people in the world. I knew them like their name was just Ray or something. But he attached himself to another person who he had no business being around. And this person, to show you how powerful the rank was, this guy had to pay a dirty cop at the time named Pac-Man, who was running that era before they cracked down on him and had to dissolve all his cases because he was so corrupt. He ended up becoming like one of the biggest enforcing extorting drug dealers. Man, he was making a killing on the streets. So that was his job. You want your man on the streets? Alright, well, what you got for me? You know, Pac-Man was the guy. Everybody knew he, they couldn't stand him. But you had to deal and work through him, or he will mess up your operation. you know, that they might do a movie on Pac-Man, but I doubt it. So anyway, the guy that was distributing to him, he was the biggest guy, but the guy distributing to him, I knew him, and he was the biggest, one of the biggest drug distributors to the entire city of Chicago. And I knew him when he was just a little kid, a teenage kid, who had like $10-$12 in his pocket. Now he's one of the biggest distributors. And he never got his hands dirty. I mean, never did. All he did was get an area popping. That was, if it was needed to be popped, or you know, get it popping, that was his job. If you were selling heroin or whatever stuff like that, you had to be outside at 4 in the morning, 5 in the morning. You know, who gonna do that? 20 below zero weather. He was out there. And then he became the biggest distributor to the West. And he did this out south. And became the biggest distributor to the West. It wasn't the other way around, which was weird. And he stayed low key. He was quiet. He was always thinking before he spoke. He was a very, very, very complicated human being at times, because you can never really guess what he's thinking. But this dude controlled so much of the drug population that when he distributed out west, these guys took it and just ran crazy style with it. Like, they were flipping bricks like crazy. So when they started distributing it to Anthony, he got to the point where he can run his own thing. Because, you know, this dude, all he does is distribute it to their chief or whatever. And I don't want to say the guy's name, but that guy that Anthony worked under, who was now running it out west, said, you know, look, little guy, you doing your thing. We going to get you your own spot. You in control of this section, but this is what you have to pay me. And what he's paying is almost double what the guy, the main distributor, is giving it to him for. Now, if you're selling that dope on the streets, you got to be out there at 4 in the morning. You got to run it like a business base of operations. You got to say, okay, you work, you got to come out here and hit them at 4. You got to hit them at 3 in the afternoon. They going to come get this at when they get their paychecks. They coming on this day. This is the day they get this check. And you got to be out there. You got to be on everything. You got to watch eyes. You got to watch hands. You got to watch everything on the streets. Because even though you doing all this, if you in a neighborhood in a town where they don't really know you, you're not from there. And it's not going to take people long to figure out that you're not from there. And who's watching your back is the next thing they're going to want to know. Can they touch you or can they rob you is next. And then after that happens, if you survive the robbery, your response to that is the most necessary and critical point in your drug dealing career. Because if you don't respond back properly or just try to brush it off as a loss, you have opened the floodgates for people to come and rob you. They will not take you seriously. They will just say, oh, this dude ain't what he say he is. And then they come in full strength. You know, and in Anthony's case, you know, he got caught up in a attempt murder beef. And he got locked up. And that's the last I heard of him. I heard he got out. And then he went right back. He went in for an attempted murder. Then he went out and he decided that he was going to turn his life around when he was up in the joint. But last I heard, he came back home. Nothing really changed. He went back to doing the same thing. He went back up for another attempt murder. So, That's the story. When you play with drugs, it has one usual ending: jail or death. I mean, those are the options. Every drug dealing story you probably have seen and heard in your life, how many of them ended with happily ever after? It's like, man, we was kings, we was doing this and that in the neighborhood, we was this, we were that. But how long does that last? How long does something like that continuously go on? You know, and when it was offered to me, you know, like I said, that guy I knew, he offered it to me. Gave me a bag of dope and gun and said, I know you can get this off. You know, I know you. We came up together in high school, this and that. I know you can get this off. That was his, he looked at me and said, I know you can get this off. Like, this is nothing. I'm finna put some money in your pocket. And I said, nah, man, that ain't me. Now, I'm smart enough to know, had I taken that bag, I was going to die. I would have been very successful. I would have had a lot of cars. I would have had the biggest gold chain. But the flip side is, I'm putting my family's life in danger. I'm putting my life in danger. And the people I'm selling it to, you think the people that was already over there selling just going to say, okay, come in and get my money? No. They're going to do what they got to do to protect their money. It's a very sad situation when you grow up in the inner city that these type of opportunities are provided to you instead of the opportunities to be successful and go to school and do the things that you might want to do to excel at a higher level. You know, most of these guys were so smart, they could have went to an Ivy League school had they had the right influence around them to tell them that this is short-term money. You know, this money that you're seeing is only going to go so many years, 2-3 years tops before you're in jail or dead. So if you want to live it up for 2-3 years, or just spend some time working your ass off to try to have something to leave back for your family, then, hey, sirrah, sirrah, but I'm just glad I was smart enough to see the bigger picture. You know, and that's how I am, baby. All right, Carcino, I'm out.